Good afternoon. Thank you for joining this congressional briefing on supporting America's creative workers. As Omicron continues to disrupt the arts and cultural sector, I look forward to our discussion of the vital work artists do, the challenges facing the sector, and the role Congress can play in ensuring that all creative workers are supported. The American Academy was created in 1780 by some of the founders of the United States to guide the new nation. Today, the Academy is a nonprofit membership organization and learned society for leaders from academia, the arts, business, philanthropy, medicine, journalism, and other areas. In keeping with our founders' vision, we are also an independent policy center devoted to finding solutions to the biggest issues facing the U.S. and the globe. Our discussion today about the creative workforce is the result of the work of the Academy's Commission on the Arts, a commission which, over the past 3 years, investigated the role of arts in American society and the value of the arts in a 21st century democracy. Led by actor and author John Lithgow, former poet laureate Natasha Trethewey, and head of the Kennedy Center, Deborah Rutter, the commission was made up of over 40 artists, scholars, activists, and leaders of institutions and philanthropies. Through the challenges of the pandemic, which has hit the arts and culture sector particularly hard, the commission was sustained by their conviction that the arts have much to contribute, both in times of crisis and recovery. It's my pleasure to turn things over to one of our co-chairs, John Lithgow, to continue the program.
Thank you so much, David, and thank you for your leadership as president of the Academy in support of us and all the other Academy commissions. Our Arts Commission is the first time in its 250-year history that the American Academy of Arts and Sciences has focused exclusively on the arts. And that's because we all feel that this is a moment of crisis for the arts. Deborah Rutter, who is with us today, and Natasha Trethewey, our former poet laureate, we three co-chairs have had an incredible 3 years. We have had a commission remarkably diverse geographically and in every other way in an effort to get the broadest possible overview of the arts in America, the arts, the exuberant successes, but also the difficulties and challenges. It's been a wonderful process with a bunch of wonderful people, one of whom you will hear from today, Laura Zabel. But halfway through our process, just like every other sector of American society, the COVID pandemic hit the creative arts community to a catastrophic degree, and our mission became a very different mission. Not just highlighting and celebrating and exploring the systemic challenges and difficulties in the arts. Suddenly it became a true crisis in the arts, and the challenge was bringing the arts back. So that was the second half of our three-year remit, and it concluded in October with two remarkable reports. One is called Art for Life's Sake, the case for arts education, and the other, Art is Work, policies to support creative workers, which of course is the one we're concentrating on today. We've already had one terrific congressional Zoom with Congresswomen Pingree and Bonamici on the subject of arts and education. It was very exhilarating. One especially gratifying aspect of it was their agenda and their hearts are in exactly the same place as ours. The parallels between our recommendations and their efforts in Congress were uncanny. And we expect that today in talking with our two invited Congress people as well. I want to, you know, being an actor, I know the good sense of having props, but I do encourage you, if you haven't already, to have a look at these and, of course, representatives themselves, but also their staffs, just to know where the Academy has come from on these issues and pay close attention to their recommendations. You'll see exactly what I'm talking about. To the extent that an actor is an artist, I am an artist too. That means in a good year, I have 4 or 5 different jobs. That makes me a very lucky actor. Not many actors work that often. And I am fully aware of what an enviable career I've had. But that also means that I've been unemployed 4 or 5 times a year. And that's given me a very strong identification with what it's like to be out of work, to share the experience of 80 or 90% of the people in my profession. And my profession is only one of the many creative arts and not necessarily the most difficult. This is why I involved myself with this. And it's why it's so deeply important to me and why I'm here advocating today. The Academy has a very specific role, of course. We are by tradition non-political, and yet we bring together the finest minds, aspirationally the finest minds in every field, and put them to work on challenges in American society. That's what we've done today. We are very, very interested to hear you ruminate on what government's role is in the arts, what it is now and what it could be. I wanted to immediately bring into the discussion Laura Zabel, who among our commissioners has taken a very strong leadership role in this particular issue because of her history in Minnesota as the executive director of Springboard for the Arts, which has always been an amazing organization for helping out workaday actors with their livelihood and their futures, but has been particularly successful during this terrible time when the challenges have been so great. Laura, I would like you to unmute yourself, talk a little bit about your own work and what you've accomplished with Springboard for the Arts.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, John, for that lovely introduction. And hello, everyone. Good afternoon. My name is Laura Zabel. Like John said, I'm the executive director of a nonprofit organization called Springboard for the Arts. And I'm talking to you today from Minnesota, which is the homeland of the Dakota and Ojibwe people. And our work happens in Minnesota. And I'm so grateful that one of the folks that we'll get to hear from today is our very own congressperson, Congresswoman Betty McCollum. So I'm really looking forward to hearing from her as a part of today. Springboard's work is to be a community and economic development organization by and for artists. So we have a staff of 20 practicing artists of all disciplines, and our work is really to support artists to make a living and a life as small business owners, as contract workers, and then to help artists connect with the other parts of their community to really engage with the biggest and most important issues facing their neighborhoods and their communities so that they can bring those creative skills to bear. And I'm just so honored and pleased to be a part of the Academy's Commission on the Arts and to get to be a part of the subcommittee that worked on this particular report, Art is Work, that focuses on the lives and the livelihoods of independent artists of all kinds in the US. My task today is to walk through some of the key recommendations of this report, but I want to start with a little bit of context setting about why artists, why we feel this conversation is so urgent among many other very urgent priorities that we know our elected leaders are grappling with right now. Firstly, there are artists in every community in America, and when we say artist, if that conjures a particular image in your mind, I'm going to ask you to stretch that a little beyond maybe what first pops into your mind. There are artists in every neighborhood, in every place, in every town, in every city, urban and rural, all across the country. Artists are performers and writers and visual artists and designers. And there is a whole expanded world of creative workers who are a part of bringing art to the public, bringing arts experiences to bear. And these artists are contributing to all kinds of different parts of our community, to healthcare, to education, to community development, and certainly to their local economies. There are about 5 million people employed in the creative economy in the US, and arts and culture contributes more to the GDP than construction or travel and tourism or agriculture. So there are these very real economic benefits to supporting artists and culture bearers in the US. But I think even more importantly, for me at least, are the reasons that we really urgently need artists right now. We need artists to help us look to the future and build what comes next. I think probably most of us, if not all of us, would say that it has never been clearer that so many things need to change. Structural racism, climate change, pandemics, all kinds of existential threats to our future and to the futures of our communities. But at the same time that we're facing all of those threats, most of us are also, and I can certainly speak for myself, experiencing a kind of imaginative exhaustion. It's just really hard to believe for a lot of folks that people and systems can change or that the future can be better than the present. And when I really think about what change is, it's an act of creation. Before we can change, we need to be able to picture and then move towards a different future. And that's what artists do. That's the work of artists, to imagine, to try things, to get feedback, to try again, to take component parts that haven't been used together and to build something new, and to create experiences that connect us to our own agency and power to change ourselves, to change our communities, and to change our systems. So we really need artists right now to help us envision and create a future that has more justice, more health, and more wholeness. Unfortunately, despite that urgent need, and as John alluded to, the last 2 years have really revealed how fragile artists' lives and livelihoods are, especially here in the US, and that the economic conditions that impact so many people in our communities, so many of us, things like the widening wealth gap, reliance on contract labor or consolidated power, the lack of basic safety net measures like healthcare, housing, unemployment benefits, those things really impact artists as well. So if we're going to count on and rely on and really realize the benefits that artists can make to a more human and equitable future, then the US really needs a better support system that makes life as an artist more sustainable and more widely available in more equitable ways. So that's the context that we brought to this new report, which is called Artist Work. And this report tries to dig into those conditions that artists and culture workers face in the US and then propose some ideas for what we can do to start to create a more equitable system of support for artists. There are four primary recommendations for policy and infrastructure changes. And we believe these are the beginnings. These changes would be the beginning of how the US could come to be a nation that really values our cultural sector in a more meaningful way, and that could be a country where we can benefit more fully from the innovation and imagination of our creative people. So I'll just really briefly go through these four recommendations. There's a lot more information in the written report, and we'll hear a lot more about what these ideas really look like in practice on the ground from both of our panels. So the first recommendation is to name and include artists in federal policy. And so I think what's important about this is that this recommendation includes both a need for increasing direct federal funding for the arts and creative workforce development through the National Endowment for the Arts, through the Small Business Administration, through the Education Department. But it also really includes a recommendation to include and name artists as allies and part of projects of recovery and part of recovery assistance at the local level. We really believe that artists can be key contributors to help with recovery efforts. So artists need to be both beneficiaries of recovery dollars and also can really help policymakers think about different ways to engage community, to repair harms, to bring new ideas to all of these other issues that we need to address with those recovery dollars. So we know, there are these new national policy resources like the American Recovery Plan and the infrastructure deal, and both of these really do allow some exciting opportunity for cities and towns to partner with artists to think creatively about the future, to increase civic participation, and to try new ideas for more meaningfully representing their communities. And I think this is a really important message that members of Congress can bring back home to the leaders in their own district, that these new resources do allow this kind of creative thinking, and that there are ways to reach out to your local arts community, to local artists and creative workers to engage them in this work. The second recommendation is to really recognize how creative work happens. So I'm sure I don't need to tell all of you that a lot of our work-related policies and workforce-related policies are really written from the perspective and from an era, I think, where we had more access to long-lasting and kind of single employment relationships. And that just doesn't really, that's no longer the standard for the general workforce, and it was never the standard for artists. So they've been ahead of the game in that way. The vast majority of artists are both self-employed and often low income. And sometimes that looks more like gig workers and contract workers, and sometimes it looks more like small business owners. I think that's kind of a unique aspect of artists, is that they kind of bridge those two worlds. So two examples of what this recommendation would look like are, firstly, to increase workplace protections for independent workers, and by including independent contractors and interns in worker protection policies, and to broaden access to unemployment insurance, healthcare, and retirement savings. The things that artists need to be sustainable are very similar to the things that most people need. And then the second piece of this would be to provide greater access to small business resources, specifically for creative businesses. A lot of our existing programs need to be adapted to the needs of solo entrepreneurs and micro enterprises to really help creative businesses. So simple changes like not requiring that businesses have an address outside of their home can make a huge difference here. This recommendation, I feel like, is particularly timely. We're seeing artists face another round of heartbreaking cancellations because of the Omicron variant. And we're just once again face to face with the reality of how little support system we have to enable and encourage creative careers. So we really, I think some of these things are fairly simple fixes to existing policy that we could act on quickly. The third recommendation from the report is that all of this policy change must center equity, specifically racial equity. The art system in this country has the same disparities that our other systems have, and has historically extracted culture from artists of color, from Black artists, from Native artists, from rural artists, artists with disabilities, and GLBTQIA artists. One of the specific recommendations here would be to focus and increase funding for arts education and arts career readiness at tribal colleges, at HBCUs, with arts organizations of color, and particularly to strengthen apprenticeships and paid internships. My good friend Omari Rush, who's the director of Culture Source in Michigan, says, being an artist in this country should be seen as an aspiration, not a risk. And I think that's a really good kind of grounding way to think about where we should start this kind of change. And then finally, the last recommendation in the report is to think locally and share nationally. So when we think about what infrastructure or ecosystem looks like to support individual artists in this country, it really lives at a local level. There are nonprofit cultural centers, schools, artist collectives, local arts agencies, service organizations, and they're really best suited to do this kind of connecting work, to connect artists with local resources, business support organizations. And we've seen this, you know, in the first few months of the pandemic, Springboard was able to convene a group of over 100 local organizations all across the country that were all providing emergency relief support and emergency relief funding to artists in their own communities. So we know this network exists, but it's been a traditionally underfunded and under-resourced network without a lot of connective tissue. So we really want to create and expand national funding that supports these local organizations like the ones you're going to hear from in the panel that's coming up, that are providing direct services to artists, and are also the ones who are really well positioned to do that kind of connecting, to help artists connect with these big community issues, to help bring creativity into these public conversations. and to really do that kind of future forward imaginative work that we need. You can read more about all of these recommendations and a lot more context in the full report. And I'll just leave you this with this idea. I really believe that artists' contributions to the work of imagining and enacting a healthier future can be profound. But I think it's also really important to say that that work doesn't happen by magic. Art is labor. Artists are workers and small business owners. And unless we build better and more equitable systems of support for artists, we're going to continue to miss out on this vital ingredient to help imagine and build a better, more just, more connected, and more human world. Thanks so much for being here. And thanks for giving me this time.
Thank you so much, Laura. That was extraordinarily eloquent. If we accomplish nothing else today, we put Laura Zabel into the field of vision of a couple of members of Congress, a fantastic go-to spokesperson for all of these issues. And you can tell from listening to Laura exactly where this report came from. You've referred, Laura, to the current body politic. It's no secret to any of us how turbulent the conflicts are, how divided we are in so many ways. All of us on the commission are optimistic, though, because art transcends politics. We have found in dealing with almost everyone that the ideas that we are discussing people respond to it from all segments of society. They like what they're doing. We like what you're doing in Congress. We're now moving on to a second portion of this program. The first, we're going to have two brief panels. The first is going to be one of our commissioners and two of the people who have participated in our roundtables. One thing that we've always stressed, as I did in my opening remarks, is the diversity of the commission. We have someone from the middle of the country and someone from the coast. We're going to start with Peter Strong, Kristen Sakota, and my co-chair, Deborah Rutter, just to talk about what it looks like for creative workers where they are. And then we will be listening to Congresswoman Teresa Ledger Fernandez and Congresswoman Betty McCollum, who have joined us to talk about what Congress can do to support many of these ideas on behalf of creative workers. I'm going to start with a few questions for Peter, Kristen, and Deborah. Mary Bordeaux, one of our commissioners, she was all scheduled to come today, but she was under the weather, but she is from the First Peoples Fund, but her colleague, Peter Strong, is stepping in with his own expertise, along with Mary. Peter is the co-owner and director of Racing Magpie, a collaborative Native artists space in Rapid City, South Dakota, and also active in regional and national arts efforts. Previously the vice president of the First Peoples Fund. Kristen Sakota is the director of Los Angeles County Department of Arts and Culture and an arts executive, attorney, and performing artist with more than 25 years in the field. She's participated in a couple of our roundtables talking about issues across the country. And finally, Deborah Rutter, who probably needs no introduction. She's right there in DC, the president of the Kennedy Center for the Performing Arts. I'm going to ask the three of you a couple of questions, but in every case, I want you to talk in terms of what we've been through in the last couple of years. And just because the pandemic is so much in the front of the minds of all of us right now, and certainly in the minds of all creative workers. Kristen, let me start with you. LA County is the most populous county in the country, arguably one of the most diverse. What have you seen from your perspective in terms of the way creative workers can make a difference in a region?
Thank you so much for having me. I'm very pleased and honored to be here and to be participating. Where I'm from, as you noted, I'm the director of the LA County Department of Arts and Culture, and we serve LA County, the region, which, as many folks may know, is one of the most populous counties. So we serve a region of more than 10 million people in a huge diverse geography of not only diverse people, over 200 languages spoken, but also over 4,000 square miles where we've got urban centers, we've got suburban, we've got rural, we've got mountain, we've got beaches and coastal. So as we do that, of course, we've got several cities there, and we have a very dynamic arts sector. So I want to just touch really briefly on kind of how we're seeing things in terms of the pandemic, as well as the impact of creative workers. Right now, our themes really embedded in so much of our work are around recovery, sustainability, and advancing equity. And I think that speaks to what we've all been through in the last couple of years, where we first had such a devastating hit. LA County is home to a huge creative economy that includes nonprofits and performing arts and has an annual output, direct and indirect, of over $200 billion every year, just LA County alone. We saw so much of that stop, just arrested. No jobs for creative workers, whether they're in film, dance, ballet, et cetera. And now, of course, fast forward, we've gone from the more the immediate relief that really all of us needed, regardless of our field, now really moving into how do we think about recovery and how do we actually reimagine the role of the arts as part of the sustainability and the equity and the recovery of not only it as a sector, but really our entire aspect of civic life, whether it's arts in education, arts in the economy, arts and community development, arts in our health and well-being, because there's so much rich lived experience, but also data that shows that arts is and can be a critical partner in this area. So we've seen all of those kinds of impacts in our work, and we're really moving through, I think, the waves and the trajectory of the pandemic and trying to shift now into more of the recovery and reimagining sustainability aspects. And happy to give more specific examples as time allows.
Thanks so much, Kristen. Peter, let me go on to you. With the First Peoples Fund and Racing Magpie, have dealt with these issues all across the country. Do you see differences in what artists need to support their work in different regions? Why don't you talk a little bit about that and what you do in South Dakota?
Sure. Well, thank you very much. And I appreciate the question and to be included here as well. And I would say, yes, there's absolutely a wide variety of needs for artists in different parts of the country. You know, much of my work has been in native and rural and remote communities in the central part of the continent and the country. So I would just offer a couple of points from that perspective. The roles of native artists and culture bearers are so intertwined completely in their communities and cultures that they often can't be told apart. Many times, not only are the whole families involved in the artistic process, from harvesting raw materials to processing them to designing the artwork and then creating them, usually the entire household is dependent upon the sales of home-based art. Also, the very infrastructure of daily life for native and rural artists are so different from more urban parts of the country. The mechanisms of connecting to markets, supplies, space, credit and capital, social networks, and even business knowledge are so different in areas that are hours away from the nearest major hub or even miles from your nearest neighbor. The livelihood of these artists I've worked with rely deeply upon those areas I just mentioned, as well as the health of the environment, the health of their languages and cultural ways, access to quality healthcare, and the effects of generational trauma. So very broad, expansive needs for success. And overall, I'd offer that the needs of artists across the country, especially native and rural artists, require on one hand that holistic and equitable approach that takes into account the way that art's integrated into the fabrics of their daily and community lives. And on the other, very tailored approaches that center local decision-making and that meet the artists where they are and that don't disrupt longstanding cultural ways of being. And to have that kind of impact on artists' needs during a pandemic recovery and beyond takes a lot of trust and creativity on everyone's part. And all of that's going to take time to be most effective.
Peter, thank you so much. It's great to have your voice in this conversation. And on such short notice at that, I might add, I do believe this is the first time you and I have even met. But it's great to hear you talking from such a completely different place than Kristen. And then we have Deborah. Before I ask her to speak, I just have to give credit to this remarkable woman. It's been just wonderful working as a co-chair with her. She straddles the world of the arts and the world of Beltway politics in the most remarkable way. And in a sense, Deborah, I'd love to hear you talk about all of these issues from the point of view of an institutionalist right inside DC.
Thanks, John. Laura, congratulations on making a beautiful presentation, really compelling and thoughtful. And to Kristen and Peter, thank you for joining us today for this conversation. You know, one of the things that I think the pandemic demonstrated to us is that artists have such a fragile network for how they put their lives together. Those of us who have worked our entire lives supporting artists have always known this. I have so many friends from the individual starting out in the career to the individual who's three or four decades into a career as an artist saying, well, I'm not sure if anybody really likes the work. I don't have another job lined up yet. There's always this sort of sense of what will happen next. And during the pandemic, all artists were equalized in that there was no work coming. At the Kennedy Center, I think about the creative workforce as not just the artists, but all of the people who work to support the artists. So we have the backstage crew, the hair and makeup, the ushers and the security guard, the people who serve at the intermission bars, who sell the drinks before you go on, who support the artist in that work. That is an entire creative workforce. And all of those people were out of work for most of those 2 years. At the Kennedy Center, that means that an individual who might normally work 6 days a week as an usher, all the way to a stagehand who might work 7 days a week backstage supporting the artist, all of those people were unemployed. Now, I see those numbers. I know what those numbers are. And what we tried to do through those years, through those months and what turned into years, is to find ways to invite them to come back, work from time to time on a project that we could offer as and where we could find that work. Normally, we have about 5,000 people who receive some form of compensation from the Kennedy Center in any given year, and we present something in the neighborhood of 2,000 performances. In that middle year, I think we presented something like 24 performances, not 2,000 performances. But we did many, many, many performances digitally, and that's how we were able to employ artists across the country and to keep them actively involved with the art. But we're talking thousands of people who did not have compensation during this period of time. And it has really brought to me the important way in which we all collectively, as a nation, need to understand and support those individuals who make up the entire creative workforce. So we were speaking directly about artists, but there are all the people around the artists who do that work as well. Whether they are, as I say, an usher or frankly, you know, one of the most highly esteemed hip hop artists who has an ongoing relationship with us at the Kennedy Center. All of us were so devastated by this impact. Now, what's been great is the acknowledgement on so many levels of what an artist and the creative workforce does for our society. And I think we're going to hear about it in the next panel, how there have been ways in which there has been support that has happened in the moment. But now what we need to do is look to the long term, not just to make up for what has happened today, but how can we support the creative workforce into the future?
Thank you so much, Deborah. Listening to you and to just about everybody today, I hear the word work over and over and over again. And it reminds me of that moment when we all talked about what to call this report. Art is work. That's what we came up with. We are workers. I mean, people tend to think of art as something that's just in the air and just easily consumed, like we breathe it in. Yes, but it is very hard work, and it is very collaborative work, and it's often extremely difficult work. This is exactly why we're anticipating for 3 years what would happen when we present these ideas to policymakers. It was so gratifying a few weeks ago talking to Congresswomen Pingree and Bonamici to hear them talk as if they were commission members. They were so aware of all of the challenges that we were constantly hearing about. They were on the case. It was extremely gratifying to hear about that, because we don't read about it in the New York Times every day. The work is going on in Congress, and I think we're going to hear evidence of that right now. I'm delighted to bring into the conversation Congresswoman Teresa Ledger Fernandez and Congresswoman Betty McCollum. Let's begin with you, Congresswoman Fernandez. From your perspective, what do you feel can be done at the federal level to support creative workers and the creative sector? And welcome, by the way.
Oh, I've loved listening to the portion I just got to hear, because it reinforces what we all know, of what that the creative economy is work, that art is work. And I come to it from a very lucky place. New Mexico, as you all know, I'm sure, is our soul is art, right? And it's a kind of art that generates so much for our economy. 1 in 10 paychecks in New Mexico comes from the creative economy. We did a report similar to what you did, a good friend of mine, several years ago. And we know that. I mean, I was very lucky. I grew up in a household where poetas y músicos were coming in and out of our door because my parents were part of the cultural renaissance. We knew that saving our identity wasn't just about, you know, bilingual education. It was about the culture. It was about the songs. It was about the lessons. And so that has motivated me to do the Creative Economy Revitalization Act, which is something that Congress can do, right? And it is inspired by the WPA, which was so important for New Mexico and so important across our country. Think of all those murals, the photographs that still inspire us. And they saved, as part of the WPA, the arts program, they saved stories. They saved songs that they collected in northern New Mexico and in Appalachia, right? It was something that brought our nation together, that preserved who we are and who we can be. And so my Creative Economy Revitalization Act recognizes that and would provide grants to the Department of Labor. It's a jobs bill in coordination with the NEA to help us build back beautiful, to help us build back poetically. And I think that that is key. We have a lot of wonderful co-sponsors, and we are trying to get it over that special line where you need to have so many that we must pass it. But other things that we can do, I liked the fact that the report talked about specific specifically mentioning arts and the creative economy in our federal programs. You know, I'm in House Ed and Labor with some of those champions you mentioned, Susan Bonamici, and I had an amendment that would have specifically called out the arts and entertainment to add to the list of apprenticeships and partnerships. I think it was about an $8 billion program. I will say that when I put in the amendment, there were those, and you can probably guess where they were coming from, who scoffed at the idea that arts was both high skilled and high wage. Unfortunately, it isn't high wage enough all the time, but it is incredibly high skilled. That amendment, though, on the hopeful side, passed by a voice vote. And so much other work that we did there was all party line, and they made us, you know, take the votes and, you know, on and on. But that one was a voice vote. Unfortunately, the Senate took that piece out. They took that piece out because they didn't want to mention any sector. So they also took out the health and, you know, all the STEM programs. So I had to put the arts in these STEM programs. But that, I think, is something that we need to constantly talk about. You know, I talked about it with Mel Wolf, who some of you might have heard about, that those apprenticeships are going to be available to them. You know, the opera, Santa Fe Opera, uses that a lot. So I think that constantly remembering what's already in your report, because we all live that. We all know the importance of art, cultura y herencia, for making our communities beautiful. In fact, I am always remembered about that beautiful poem, like how much did that poem inspire us, right? That Amanda Gorman's poem, which is, being American is more than a pride we inherit. It's the past we step into and how we repair it. And I think that arts and culture is one of those places where we both put people back to work. We help celebrate each other, right? Here in New Mexico, it's Latinos, Native Americans, you know, everybody is involved in this. And it is a way that we have come to understand each other. It's how we end up having empathy for the issues of our day. So it is indeed how we repair it, how we repair our America. So I want us to build back poetically. I want us to build back beautifully. And I want us to include all that you have in that report in our federal work going forward.
Thank you so much, Representative. It's absolutely wonderful to hear your voice and all the energy and excitement and positivism in it. What about you, Congresswoman McCollum? Your colleague has given you a hard act to follow. But I am interested in what you face when you put forward these programs. What are the dialogues like? Do you find the other side to be persuadable? I'm so accustomed to facing the dismaying news that things run up against that terrible divide on one side of the house and the other. Do you find it's easy to breach that divide?
Well, it's easy to work with Teresa. We work on a lot of issues together, and she didn't even mention how she is making sure that Native American art is respected and not just sold on the open market, that it's repatriated when appropriate. So John, that's a great question. And you mentioned about, is it being an actor, you know, art early on when you were speaking. And as a person whose work study that got me through college was being in the performing arts, I couldn't get work study credit for acting. So I learned how to run a light board. And, it was kind of a misconnect. It always seemed to me like, you know, the hours I put in doing one thing weren't, you know, rewarded in the same way that they were for running a set or doing something like that. And I want to give Laura a shout out. She is just amazing with what she's done with Springboards in the Arts in Minnesota. She's my constituent in St. Paul. And one of the things that she's worked on for a long time that was so important during the pandemic was to make sure that artists had access to healthcare. And that's another thing, John, as you know, quite often becomes a divide here in Congress, who has access to healthcare. I want to assure you, though, there are many of us, and we have friends on the other side of the aisle who know the value of the arts in our communities. And one of the reasons why, you know, you were talking about the education programs, it's called STEM. In Minnesota, we like to call it STEAM. We add the arts, because if you're going to be creative as an engineer, as an architect, a problem solver, the arts are so important in that. The arts provide hope and insight, as has been pointed out. But even more, I think we know how important the arts, we navigate our way out of this pandemic. And we have to remind our colleagues in Congress all the time that arts and culture just don't improve our lives, but they're how millions of our fellow Americans contribute nearly $920 billion to our economy alone in 2019. And so I've read it and it works, and we're going to take it around and tell our colleagues what we need to do better, because in order to build back better, we need everybody participating in the build. So that's why Congress included $135 million in the American Rescue Plan for the National Endowment for the Arts. The money is reaching state and local governments and agencies and organizations, and it provides critical support to artists and creative workers. And we did get some pushback about putting those dollars in there. But as I said, we do have some friends on the other side of the aisle. Just last Thursday, the NEA announced another $57 million in grants to 567 arts organizations, including Springboard for the Arts Back Home. And the NEA moved really quick politically when they realized that the grants for performances were going to be canceled. We worked with them in the Appropriations Committee to make sure that that funding still went out in the community, supports arts and artists. So I have to tell you, I'm excited about what we can do here in Congress. I'm excited about the opportunities for the arts and artists, especially as we work on the historic bipartisan infrastructure deal. And I'm going to give you a couple of examples here at home in Minnesota. When we constructed the Green Line, which was a light rail system, it totally disrupted University Avenue, home to so many vibrant immigrant new refugee businesses. And some old historic businesses in St. Paul. So what Springboard for the Arts did is they made sure that they worked with local small businesses and with artists to make opportunities for culture to be expressed and to be shared, whether it was putting up art on buildings, whether it was working with small businesses on that Friday when the construction ended and they were going to be open for the weekend to get some outdoor music or opportunities. It was really amazing, and it just opened up our community to even experience more of the arts. But the other thing we can do, and I say this as a history teacher, we also had in Minnesota a sad legacy of a transportation project. It cut through, just ripped apart a vibrant middle and upper class African-American community. It was called the Rondo neighborhood. And it was just ripped apart in the 60s. And I'm working in my role with my colleagues here to make sure that the Biden administration addresses this injustice. And we can do it in two ways. We can help revitalize the community and the neighborhood with the future Build Back Better projects, but we can also do it by telling a story. One of the things that we did in St. Paul on the Dale Street Bridge is we told the story not only of Rondo, but we told the story of all the new immigrants who have come well too. And these projects, I know that they don't erase the impact of past harms, but it gives us a chance to learn more about why we shouldn't repeat the mistakes of the past. So I believe the arts in the Build Back Better bill can build back stronger, more vibrant communities with more hope and opportunity. So I'm going to keep pushing to increase the NEA funding. It was tough, zeroed out during the Trump years, but they wanted to eliminate it altogether. But we banded together as Congress to keep that from happening. So please know that your work and dedication on what you've given us as a blueprint will be well used in Congress to make the ask to do more for the arts, to do more for it, to celebrate our culture and to learn more from one another. So I just want to encourage all the arts and artists who are here to keep talking to, you know, Shelley and Susanna and Teresa and I. We want to hear from you. You help us recharge our batteries, and you gave us a great blueprint to work on. And so I want to say thank you. And as Laura pointed out, I have the privilege of living on Dakota and Ojibwe land. Thank you, McGwich.
Thank you so much, Representative. It's just wonderful, again, to hear your voice as well. And I think I can speak for everybody else who is on this call, including the staff of the Academy. We really do want to put ourselves at your disposal, anything that we can do to help you. You certainly are doing everything you can to help us and whatever that we've tried to accomplish in our little way. It's really great to hear you all talk. And I also thank you for being so good with your timing. We wanted to allow for some Q&A, and we have 10 generous minutes for it. I think I'm going to relinquish my MC duties and hand them over to Rob Townsend. Rob, you are curating the questions that have come in.
Yes, I am. Thank you, John. So the first question we had actually, I think, was directed to Kristen to ask you to, I think, go into some of that data that you described about the sort of the effects of the COVID pandemic on the situation in LA.
Sure, happy to give just a couple examples. I want to just acknowledge that, for example, the Los Angeles County Board of Supervisors here, under their leadership, allocated $12 million of CARES Act relief dollars that came to us. And we at the department were able to administer a relief grant that was for arts organizations. We had over 300 different organizations of different sizes apply. And when we asked them in that application, how are you going to use the money? So often it was for personnel, it was for hiring, it was for getting people back. We also asked them, how many losses and unanticipated expenses have you experienced at that time? Well, over 300 organizations, we had $12 million to give out. They cited over $230 million in losses and unanticipated expenses. So as much as we're trying to shift towards what's the future of sustainable recovery, I want to say funding is still critically needed, and we still really see it in the field. I would also just share the Otis report on the creative economy is an incredible document in terms of understanding this, that so many of today's speakers talked about. The creative economy is an ecosystem. It is artists, it is educators, it is Hollywood, it is small budget, it is nonprofit, it is performing arts, designers. So to really begin to understand that and support and sustain it through policy, through funding, through economic support, and how it supports our healing, I think is the charge before us. But the Otis report is a great place to look at it as economic activity for the LA and California region.
Thanks, Kristen. I think one of the other questions comes up in relationship to something you mentioned, Peter, which is the issue of sort of more rural arts and the challenges that you face. Could you maybe talk just a little bit more about what the challenges are that might be different from those who are in more urban spaces, like Deborah and Kristen?
Yeah, I will try and summarize them all very quickly. You know, as I mentioned before, we're just spread out so differently. The infrastructure here is so different in the middle of America. We've got just everything from government to funding to the importance that artists placed in the community and in decision making as well. And I think it's that the some of the differences are also complemented by some of the reality and the similarities with what is out there in the rest of the country too, that there's never enough funding to go around to support our community and of artists, artists and culture bearers. And again, in Native communities, especially art and life ways and everyday life can't be pulled apart. Art is not a separate piece. Art is not a commodity in many ways. It's really part of community and culture. And that's a different format to be supported too, and to be recognized in an equitable space.
Next question, I think maybe I'll aim at Laura, is what are some strategy ideas you may have to strengthen connections with historically marginalized populations, of which creatives often have little to no access to capital and sustainable work opportunities?
Yeah, I think that's a super important question. And I think, you know, sort of building off some of the recommendations in the report, I think access to capital, particularly for artists who are from marginalized communities, is a really important piece of this. And I think one of the best recommendations in there is to make sure that those artists are represented in small business support, in other workforce development. I think there, what we're seeing here is that there's a whole lot of new access to capital through community development financial institutions and other kinds of systems for small business, and specifically for small businesses run by and for people of color or in rural places or folks with disabilities. But there's a lot of lingering language in those systems that often exclude people who are running home-based businesses, who don't have a business address outside of their own home, or who are running what we would call micro-enterprises that are just one or two people whose sort of economic aim is to feed themselves and their family, which, by the way, are businesses that are kind of by definition built to stay local, so really have this ongoing impact on local economies. So I think it's in some of the nuance of that kind of support can be really meaningful change to get people access to capital in the same way that we're trying to get access to capital for, you know, folks who are running restaurants or other kinds of locally based businesses. And then the other thing I'll just quickly say about that is I also think there's a lot of space for us to think more creatively about business structures supporting artists who are starting cooperatives or other kinds of business incorporations that might be more well suited both to the kind of business that they're starting and culturally more relevant to the work that they're making.
Thanks, Laura.
Well, could I actually
add? Yes, yes.
Yeah, I'd like to add to that and do a shout out for some work we were doing here in New Mexico. I was part of an organization, helped lead it called HomeWise for about 20 years. And we actually created a lending program that was specifically addressed creatives that said, because we realized, and then we built homes and so that there would be both the studio and then the living space, and then created in working with the CDFI, working so that they would then have access to the capital for their studio, and then had access to our programs to actually purchase that home with the studio attached. And I think that kind of work is really important in terms of expanding, like, the ability for artists to build their wealth, because we know it's often through capital and too much expense goes out in rent. And so I think that thinking about the artist in terms of the life cycle is important. And just real quickly on the John's question about the bipartisanship, I will tell you that my bill, the creative economy, is bipartisan. I believe the bill with regards to, I also am co-leading the bill on the Writers Project, you know, and we are getting bipartisan support for that. And I am working also and raised with the Secretary Buttigieg and all the secretaries that looking at doing a 1% for the arts, which we do here in New Mexico, but we don't do nationally. I mean, Secretary Buttigieg was like, oh my God, I'd love to have that, right? Because they do it in so many places. But that kind of 1% of the arts, when we are building all the building that we're doing in New Mexico, the money that's going to come here is going to have that set aside, but in other places it's not. And we're working on having that adopted, because then you regionalize it so that you have that 1% going to all those small projects that are going to be built all over this country. And that then helps the artists all over the place. And many of those are small projects and smaller artists in terms of, those are mostly installations and murals and stuff, but they're still great.
Thanks so much. Well, incredibly, we have hit time. So John, I feel like I need to turn it back to you. Sorry.
Yes, Rob, I'm glad that you all got a glimpse of Rob Townsend, one of the incredible staff of the Academy, which have supported the commission and really enabled absolutely everything that we've done. And this includes Lance Michelle and Tanya Munes and Peter Robinson. Almost anyone I mention is going to leave out a few, but I wanted to give one last thank you to all of you to making events like this possible. And today's event was fantastic. It was wonderful to meet all you new friends and have all my old friends here with us. I just want to say goodbye to everyone, but be very aware as you walk out into your lives, just how often you will interact with the creative arts by the time you sleep tonight. What you hear, what you see, where you go, all around you is the work of our creative artists. And just remember that and act on it. Usually we have our splendid third co-chair with us, Natasha Trethewey, to conclude with one of her own poems or with a favorite poet of hers. She couldn't be here today. So I'm simply going to read one of our seminal quotes from John Kennedy. This is how we'll conclude today's webinar, and listen to it carefully because it expresses exactly what we want to happen about 50 years later. I look forward to an America which will reward achievement in the arts as reward achievement in business or statecraft. I look forward to an America which will steadily raise the standards of artistic accomplishment and which will steadily enlarge cultural opportunities for all our citizens. And I look forward to an America which commands respect throughout the world, not only for its strength, but for its civilization as well. Thank you all for being with us today. This meeting is adjourned.